This is the first video in a series about the Shannon entropy. Entropy is a confusing subject as there are many things that are called entropy. A thermodynamic entropy, Boltzmann, Gibbs, von Neumann entropies. In some cases they are the same, in some other they are not. Here we are going to be mainly talking about the Shannon entropy. We will give a characterization that works in all contexts it is applied, not just information theory, but also physics, ecology, economics, and so on. We are going to derive the expression in three different ways, which you have to see at least once if you want to understand anything. We'll also address the issue of coordinate invariance. In fact, the continuous version of Shannon entropy is not in general coordinate invariant, but it is on physical spaces. And finally, we'll see the link between the Shannon entropy and statistical mechanics. So, lots of things to cover, lots of misunderstanding to clear up. Let's start. The expression itself is pretty simple. We have a set of elements characterized by a distribution. The PIs represent the normalized fraction for each case. The Shannon entropy is minus the sum of P log P. The basic question is, what does it measure? And usually people use vague words like disorder, information, lack of information, uncertainty. And in some cases, these words are useful, but in others, they're misleading. What I want is a characterization that always works, that is intuitive, and it is clear enough to be able to rederive the mathematical expression. The idea is that minus P log P measures the variability of the elements within a distribution, within a set. How different they are from each other. What does that mean? Well, consider these three sets. The first one has very little variability. Almost all the elements are circles. They are almost all similar to each other. The second one, there is more variability. Still, most elements are similar to each other. In the third one, there is even more variability. Just visually, you see that the elements in the last sets are more varied than the first one. The Shannon entropy of the first set will be lower than the second, which will be lower than the third. That's the idea. But you should not take my word for it. Many people are confused about entropy. Maybe I'm confused too. So I'll make a detailed argument, derive the expression, and that argument has to convince you. But before we can be precise on the meaning of the Shannon entropy, we have to be precise on the meaning of the PIs. And that's another source of confusion because we can have different kinds of distributions. We could have a statistical distribution. We actually have n distinct objects, each exhibiting a value of the property. So the PI represents the fraction of the object in the ith case. For example, 66% of the atoms of the fluid are hydrogen. We could have a probability distribution. We have one object taken from a population. The PI represents the chance that the object corresponds to the ith case. For example, there is a 66% chance that the atom in the magnetic trap is hydrogen. We could also have a credence distribution. We have one object and we believe it has this or that property. For example, I have 66% confidence that the atom in the trap is hydrogen. These are distinct cases talking about slightly different things. But the Shannon entropy can be applied to all, and we'll describe something different. The variability of what is there, the variability of what could be there, or the variability of what one thinks is there. In my experience, this is a major source of confusion. Suppose you learn information theory as part of a class on machine learning. You're dealing with credence, what the machine thinks is there. So you think, the Shannon entropy is about credence, about Bayesian probability and how to do inference. Or you learn Shannon entropy as part of ecology. You may be dealing with statistical distribution of animal and characterization in different species. And you think, Shannon entropy is about statistical distribution. Very different perspectives. What's worse is that in physics, we have a bit of all three. We have statistics, collection of large number of particles. We have probabilities, ensembles, that describe repeated experiments or fluctuations in time. And we have confidence intervals in measurement with some aspect of Bayesian probability. In fact, you can combine these things. You may have 30% confidence that there is 50% chance that 66% of the atoms are hydrogen. You can have a credence distribution over a probability distribution over a statistical distribution. And if you don't understand precisely at what level you're working, you're going to be completely confused. So first you have to understand that all these types of distribution are indeed valid, they're useful, and be clear on what are the definition in your case. Okay, so we have a distribution, whatever the kind. And we ask, what is the variability of the elements? How are they different from each other? And some will say, we already have a way to do that. It's the variance. You calculate the expectation of the square of the difference from the mean. But look, we have a distribution over shapes. What is the average shapes? How do you calculate the average shape? The problem is the variance only works for numeric quantities, things you can subtract, square, and sum. And not everything is a numeric quantity. But even for numeric quantity, the variance does not work. Suppose we have two cases. In both, x equals 0 99% of the time. And for the rest, in the first case you have x equal 1, and in the second, x equal 10. Now the variance will be different, but the variability is the same. 99% of the cases are similar to each other, and the remaining 1% are similar to each other. So the elements are similar to each other in the same way. So no, the variance is not a good indicator for variability. Okay, what would be a good indicator for variability? What should a good indicator be like? Well, let's cover some requirements. First of all, we would want it to be a continuous function of the PIs. It should not depend on the specific value, but only on how the elements are grouped in those values. After all, it's how similar they are to each other. So it should depend on the PIs only and not on the values themselves. And we want small changes in the distribution to give small changes in the variability. So if H is the indicator, H is a function of PI. And if we make a small changes in the PI, we should have a small change in the indicator. Second, if the number of cases used increases, we want the indicator to increase. More precisely, if we have a uniform distribution over n cases, we want the variability to increase as n increases, to be a monotonically increases function of n. If we say u is a uniform distribution, then the variability h of a uniform distribution over I cases should be less than the variability of a uniform distribution over j cases if I is less than j. Third, we want the indicator to be linear in PI. This is tricky to describe, it's easier to understand with the example. Suppose I have a distribution over four shapes. Now I want to expand the distribution of the triangle into three subcases, acutangle, obtusangle, or rectangle. I will have a final distribution over all cases. We want the variability of the final distribution to be the variability of the initial distribution plus the variability of the distribution we're using to expand, weighted by the probability of the case we are expanding. Expanding means increasing the original variability by the variability of the expansion weighted by the fraction of elements we are expanding. You see, we have a linear combination where pi are the coefficients. So these are the three properties that we require. If you stop and think about them, you can see that they are very reasonable properties. The first two, you can't really do without. If you don't satisfy them, you don't have an indicator of variability. The third one is not strictly necessary, but it makes the expression a lot more useful. Now we have to show that minus p log p is the only indicator that satisfies these conditions. Here we go, first derivation of the series. Pause if I'm going too fast. Let's consider this case. We start with a uniform distribution over n cases, in this example 2. We expand each case with a uniform distribution over m cases, in this example 3. So the first case is expanded in 3 cases and the second in other 3 cases. We get a distribution of n times m cases, in this example 2 times 3, 6. We use the third property and set up the following. The variability over a uniform distribution over nm cases, 6 in the example, but the third property is the variability over n uniform cases plus the variability over m cases times the probability of being in that case, 1 over n. Since we expand all n cases, we sum this contribution n times. But 1 over n summed n times is 1, so we have the variability over m cases. So the product of the cases becomes the sum of the variability. We can use property 1, continuity, to use Cauchy's functional equation, which tells us that the logarithm is the only function, apart from a constant k, for which the function of the product is the sum of the function. Property 2, monotonicity, tells us that the constant k must be positive. So now we know the functional form of the variability of a uniform distribution. Neat. Let's consider another case. We have a distribution where all the PIs are rational, all with the same numerator. We can imagine expanding each case with a uniform distribution of ni cases. So in the example, first case is 1/6, we expand it with a uniform distribution over one case. The second case is 3/6, we expand it using a uniform distribution over 3 cases. The third case is 2/6, and we expand it over 2 cases. Again, we can use the third property and write that the variability of the final distribution, which is a uniform distribution over n cases, is equal to the variability of the original distribution plus, for each case, the probability of that case times the variability of the distribution we used to expand, which is a uniform distribution over ni cases. Since we know the variability over uniform distributions, we have k log n equal variability of the original distribution plus the sum of pi k log ni. And now we just need to do some algebra. We bring this to the other side, and we have that the variability of the distribution is k log n minus the sum pi k log ni. Sum of pi is equal to 1, so we can insert it here. K sum pi is in both terms, so we collect it. The difference of the log is the log of the ratio. Note that n over ni is the reciprocal of pi, and the log of the reciprocal is minus the log. And by the way, this is going to be a recurring theme. The minus you get in front of the log is because you are taking the reciprocal of the log. And we'll see in the second derivation why exactly this happens. Anyway, we got our expression. The variability is minus k p log p. But wait, we assume the pi's were rational, but we can use property 1, continuity, so the limit will converge for real numbers as well. And now we're really done. So the Shannon entropy measures the variability of the elements within a distribution. No matter what the distribution, statistical, probability, credence, and no matter what the distribution is applied to. It's a very general tool. It is the only indicator of variability that is continuous, monotonic, and linear. So it's not some arbitrary expression, it's the only one we can have. The three requirements are actually the same properties Shannon used in his paper, though Shannon applied them to the more restrictive case of a source of messages with a given probability. The whole point is that the expression is broadly applicable to a lot of different things, not just variability of messages over an information channel. The derivation is not exactly the one from Shannon, it's something I put together that I think is more straightforward and focuses on the elements that are more conceptually important.